everyone. And welcome to our final evening of Theology on the Rocks. Once again, I'd like to just take a moment to introduce myself. My name is Rachel Espinoza, and I'm the new director of Children and Family Catechesis here at St. Clement Parish. And tonight, it is my great joy and pleasure to introduce our guest speaker, Father Ed Shea. Father Ed grew up as the third of eight children and attended St. Giles Parish in Oak Park. After graduating from Fenwick High School and the University of Notre Dame, Father Ed Shea joined the Franciscans in 1980 and was ordained a priest in 1987. Since then, he's served for many years in parish work, including time at St. Giles in Oak Park, St. John the Baptist Catholic Church in Joliet, and St. Joseph's Parish in the Back of the Yards neighborhood. Father Ed is currently living and working out of St. Peter's in the Loop here in downtown Chicago. And if Father Ed Shea's joyful voicemail is any indication of what we're about to experience, we are in for a real treat. So please join me in giving a warm welcome to Father Ed Shea.
Make me a channel of your peace. Where there is hatred, let me bring your love. Where there is injury, your pardon, Lord. And where there's doubt, true faith in you. Good evening, everyone. I want to thank you for your kind hospitality. Thanks to Rachel for that wonderful introduction. Thank you for being here tonight. You know, this is now the second time that I've been to St. Clement's for a talk. And I was thinking on the way here, you know, it's always nice to be invited somewhere, but it's even better to be invited back. I'm happy to be here. I'm happy to talk to you tonight about the great sacrament of reconciliation. The title of my talk is, Bless Me, Father, for I Have Sinned. It's been a long time since my last confession. I want to invite you to think about tonight the great gift that this sacrament offers us, and also to, you know, talk about it in a larger sense, not so much about going to confession as much as to celebrate God's mercy. Make me a channel of your peace. Where there's despair in life, let me bring hope. Where there is darkness, only light. And where there's sadness, ever joy. You know, that peace prayer of St. Francis is a really good prayer. Have you heard it before? It's one I often give it out. I'll give it out as a penance in the confessional. I said, you know the peace prayer of St. Francis? And the person will say, no. And I said, you know, it's the one that starts, Lord, make me an instrument of you. Oh, yeah, I know that one. I just don't know the title, right? And, you know, the thing about it is it really is a good way to kind of assess your life. It's a good, what you might call, examination of conscience, right? It's what we all want. You know, I always say, nobody gets up in the morning and says, gee, I wonder how I could ruin somebody's day today. No, we get up in the morning and we say, all right, another day. Lord, make me an instrument of your peace. Where there's hatred, let me sow love. Where there's injury, pardon. Where there's doubt, faith. Where there's despair, hope. Where there's darkness, light. It's what we want, right? Everybody has this deep desire in the soul. And you know when you're not doing it, right? The prayer is not, like all of our prayers, it's not magic. You know, God doesn't say, oh, okay, you want to be an instrument? Oh, I'm making it. Sure, I'll do that for you. It's not like that. When you ask to be an instrument of peace, God will give you an opportunity, right? You want to be an instrument of peace? Look for conflict. You know, you want to be a little more loving? Look for a situation that needs love, right? Some situation of darkness in your family, in your work, with your friends in the neighborhood, right? You want to be more patient? Wait in line. It's really not that complicated, right? The invitation here is to, you know, remind ourselves, basically, of our baptism. You know, it all begins at baptism. It all begins with this powerful relationship with a God who loves us and calls us by name. I have called you. I have called you by name. I have loved you, and you are mine. You know, the first question that we ask at baptism, do you remember when you baptized your kids or your grandchildren? What's the first question that the church asks? What do you want for your child? Nope. Well, you weren't supposed to answer that. People are mistaken. You know, it's not. You know, what do you belong to the church? Do you have envelopes? Are you a registered member? That's what happens sometimes in the parish office. And when I was working on the south side, I used to tell the secretary, I said, the answer to the people's question is yes. Whatever they want, the answer is yes. We have to figure out a way to say that. You know, so often you go to the parish office, and the first answer you get is no. You know, you want, can I baptize my baby? Well, are you a registered member of the parish? Are you using your envelopes? Yeah. Those are the wrong questions to start with. The first question that we ask at baptism is, what name have you given to this child? Isn't that powerful? I mean, you think about that, right? The first thing God wants to know, what's her name? I'm so glad we all have name tags, right? I want to invite you tonight to meet somebody you don't know. Get to know somebody by name. This is what it means to be Catholic. You know, we're called to know each other and call each other by name. You know, baptism is where it begins. This is a covenantal relationship with God. And when we sin, think about this. When we sin, mostly what we're doing is forgetting who we are. We're forgetting our name. Make me, oh Master, grant that I may never see so much to be consoled as to console, to be understood as to understand, to be loved as to love with all my soul. So I'm coming here from St. Peter's Church, downtown Chicago. And, you know, one of the things about St. Peter's that a lot of people don't know is that what we don't do. At St. Peter's, we don't celebrate baptisms. At St. Peter's, we don't celebrate weddings. We don't celebrate funerals. We don't celebrate quinceañeras, a 15-year-old girl having a celebration. We don't have all those kinds of things. We don't have any catechesis. We don't have any children. You know what we do? Mass and confessions. We have seven masses a day, and we have confession from 7:30 in the morning until 6 at night. Every day, all day. And I'm telling you, it's a wonderful ministry. You know, Holy Name Cathedral likes to say, we are the church where Chicago prays. Well, St. Peter's is the church where Chicago goes to confession. And we're proud of that, you know. I want to invite you to come. I want to invite you to participate in this sacrament. Enter maybe even more deeply into your own mission and ministry in the church and the world, you know. To clear it up, to clear up the brokenness and what's not quite right. You know, the other thing about the Peace Prayer of St. Francis is that it's really an invitation into community. We belong to each other. We're not in this thing by ourselves, right? I always like to think of it as, it's kind of a great orchestra. You know, the orchestra of God. And each person has a part to play, has a song to sing. So the first question I want to invite you to think about tonight is, are you playing your part? Are you singing your song? Are you the Christian that you want to be? Are you the Christian that God wants you to be? I think that's a fundamental question, right? And as we gather here tonight, I want you to think about the invitation of God that asks you to be the person that God calls you to be. It reminds me of my nephew. I have 19 nephews and nieces. And several of them through the years have picked up the trumpet. I myself play the trumpet. And so they have said, I'm going to be like Uncle Eddie. I'm going to play the trumpet. So my nephew picked up the trumpet. And you know how it is when you remember this, when your kids started playing instruments, how bad it sounded? You know. So Kevin picks up the horn and he starts playing. Rah, rah, rah. It just sounds terrible. Everybody was like, man, who killed the cat? That sounds like awful. And then one day, without ever really improving, Kevin comes running home from school and he puts his trumpet case on the floor of the kitchen. He goes, Mom, you know what? He says, I sound really good when the whole band is playing. Now I want to invite you to think about that as a wonderful image of the church, right? None of us is really meant to be a soloist, right? But we sound really good when the whole band is playing, all right? Make me a channel of your peace. It is in pardoning that we are pardoned, in giving of ourselves that we receive, and in dying that we're born to eternal life. Anybody here remember the old Baltimore Catechism?
Oh, yeah.
I suppose we do, you know. I give a lot of talks to young adults these days, and, you know, they never had any of that experience. They never did that. And I tell them, you know, the thing about the Baltimore Catechism it was that it was just full of answers. It had all the answers. Now we have all the questions. I kind of prefer now to then. Let me be honest. You know, I think a lot, having more questions is better than having more answers. But the Baltimore Catechism was correct in a fundamental way, which said that we are all on our way to heaven. The goal in life is to get to heaven. But I think, and I'm happy to say, that the church has kind of opened up that reflection a little bit more, you know, than it used to be. And we think about heaven today. I mean, who's up there, right? Who gets to go to heaven? I mean, you know, I don't think we can be as limiting as we used to be. I remember growing up, you know, in my little world, there were two kinds of people, Catholics and publics. I mean, even the Catholic kids who went to the public school were a little suspect, you know. So those days are gone. And I'm glad they're gone in that sense, you know, that there's a more openness. Like there's a great joke about a guy dies and goes to heaven, and St. Peter starts showing him around, and they walk down this one corridor, and there's all these people dancing and clapping and laughing. It's the Baptist section. And then they turn the corner, and they see all these people dressed in black, and black coats and big hats and curls coming out of their ears. It's the Jewish section, even in heaven, right? And then they go down another corridor, and it's real quiet. It's the Quaker section, right? And then they turn the corner, and they're walking down the hall, and St. Peter turns to the guy, and he says, listen, this, you got to be quieter in this section. This is the Catholic section, and well, they think they're the only ones up here. You know, here's the good news, right? We believe in a God of redemption. You know, I had this a conversation with a man last night who was asking me about salvation. What does it mean to be saved, and who gets saved, and all that. And I said, you know, here's what we believe. The death and resurrection of Jesus Christ is the salvific event in history for everyone. It's not limited to Catholics. It's not limited to Christians. It's not limited to people who profess their faith in Jesus Christ. Everyone gets a chance. Isn't that great? So be careful about who you think gets into heaven. You know, did you ever hear this? There's a great joke. I remember a great story. I read this years ago. I was shocked and confused and bewildered as I entered heaven's door, not by the beauty of it all, nor by the lights or its decor, but it was the folks in heaven who made me sputter and gasp, the thieves, the liars, the sinners, the alcoholics, and the trash. There stood that kid from seventh grade who swiped my lunch money twice. Next to him was my old neighbor who never said anything nice. Bob, who I always thought was rotting away in hell, was sitting pretty on cloud nine, looking incredibly well. I nudged Jesus. What's the deal? I would love to hear your take. How'd all these sinners get up here? God must have made a mistake. And why is everyone so quiet, so somber? Give me a clue. Hush, child, Jesus said. They're all in shock. No one thought they'd be seeing you. All right. I want to talk to you tonight not so much about the actual sacrament of reconciliation as much as about the energy of forgiveness. You know, I want to talk to you in the spirit of Pope Francis. Do you love Pope Francis? I don't know. Maybe it's because he's such a Franciscan Jesuit, you know. What a great combination. But there's something about Pope Francis that has really shaped a new energy in the world. Am I right about that?
Yeah.
And one of his great themes is the theme of mercy. He talks about mercy all the time. And I just want to invite you to kind of get into that in your own life. Now think about the difference between divine mercy and human mercy. You know, human mercy is kind of quid pro quo, right? I offend you. I realize I offended you. I ask your forgiveness, and you maybe forgive me, maybe you don't. Divine mercy is a whole other energy, right? Divine mercy is this preemptive mercy. It's proactive mercy. It's mercy before you even know you need it, you know. Jesus said on the cross, Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. Think about that. Those soldiers never asked for forgiveness. Those disciples who ran away from Jesus weren't asking him, weren't recognizing what they did wrong. It's like the energy of mercy. So what I want to do tonight is talk about it in the context of the so-called prodigal son story. I want to talk about it first, that image of God in the story, and then the two brothers, the two sons, and how each of them has a different problem with forgiveness. You with me?
Mm-hmm.
All right. You know, Rachel, I'm wondering about this thing because it looks like it's pointing behind me. Not that I'm not that good looking. It doesn't matter that much. You want to kind of get it over this way. A reading from the Gospel of Luke. The tax collectors and the sinners were all gathering around to hear Jesus, at which the scribes and the Pharisees murmured, "This man welcomes sinners and eats with them." Then Jesus addressed this parable to them. A man had two sons. The younger of them said to his father, "Father, give me the share of the estate that is coming to me." So the father divided up the property. Some days later, this younger son collected all his belongings and went off to a distant land where he squandered his money on dissolute living. After he had spent everything, a great famine broke out in that country, and he was in dire need. So he attached himself to one of the property class of the place, who sent him to his farm to take care of the pigs. And you need to know, I think you already know, that in the first century Judaism, you know, taking care of pigs was like the lowest of the low. You know, it was a bad job. It was a job that no one would talk about having. You know, taking care of the pigs was really. And of course, Jewish people even to this day don't eat pork, and they don't. You know, and it's a kind of a dark thing. And notice this, how this is all about relationships. Notice how the two sons talk to each other and about each other. Listen up. Well, they don't talk to each other. They're about each other. So, he went to say, he was taking care of the pigs. Oh, how he longed to fill his belly with the husks that were fodder for the pigs. But no one made a move to give him anything. Coming to his senses at last. I love that line. You think about your life, right? Moments in your life when you say, geez, coming to his senses at last. You look yourself in the mirror and you say, wow. That, you know, I don't deserve this, or I got to do something different. You know, coming to his senses at last, he said, "How many hired hands at my father's house have more than enough to eat, while here I am starving? I know. I will break away and return to my father, and I'll say to him, 'Father, I've sinned against God and against you. I no longer deserve to be called your son.'" This is his self-identity. "I am no longer a son. Treat me like one of your hired hands." With that, he set off. While he was still a long way off. It's another, just think about this. What a great line, you know. While he was still a long way off, his father caught sight of him and was deeply moved. He ran out to meet him, threw his arms around him, and kissed him. The son said to the father, "Father, I've sinned against God and against you. I no longer deserve to be called your son." The father said, "The servants, quick, bring out the finest robe and put it on him, put a ring on his finger and shoes on his feet. Take the fatted calf and kill it. Let us eat and celebrate, because this son of mine was dead and has come back to life. He was lost and is found." Then the celebration began. Meanwhile, the elder son was out on the land. As he neared the house on his way home, he heard the sound of music and dancing. He called one of the servants and asked him for the reason for the dancing and the music. The servant answered, "Your brother is home, and your father has killed the fatted calf because he has him back in good health." This son grew angry at this and would not go in. But his father came out and began to plead with him. He said to his father in reply, "For years now I've slaved for you. I never disobeyed even one of your orders. Yet you never gave me so much as a kid goat to celebrate with my friends. Then when this son of yours," not my brother, "this son of yours returns after having gone through your property with loose women." By the way, nobody mentions loose women in the story except him. "You killed the fatted calf for him?" "My son," replied the father, "you are always with me, and everything I have is yours. But we had to celebrate and rejoice. This brother of yours was dead and has come back to life. He was lost and is found." Amazing.
Amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me.
Sing it.
I once was lost, but now am found. Was blind, but now I see.
This story that I just read has been named, you know, the prodigal son story. But it also has other names. Some people call it the prodigal father story. And some people call it, because it's in the 15th chapter of the Gospel of Luke, it's one of the lost and found parables. I think the title of it should be Amazing Grace. It's about mercy, right? About a God who has mercy. There is this great image of this Father, and it's a perfect image of God, you know? All that images of like longing for his son. First of all, you're parents, right? Grandparents? Think about this, you know? The guy says, give me half of your money. And the father, you know, could have said no and should have said no. And he knew, let's be honest, he knew that the kid was going to blow it. And he did it anyway. You know that, right? You had this experience in your own family, you know, situations where your sister says something and you know she's not, but they have to do it, right? The father knew it, right? And the son coming to his senses at last, and he's turning around, but he's really not ready to be forgiven. He just wants to fill his belly. You know, and the father, I love that scene. While he was still a long way off, can you imagine this father? Again, think about your own experience, right? Your child, your grandchild. The father is looking every day, looks out the window. Man, what's going on with that kid of mine? That goofy kid of mine, what's he doing out there? Jeez. Every day, looks out the window, you know. And then, you know, he hears about the famine. Oh, you know, I'm sure all the money that my kid took from me is gone, but now where is he at? What's he doing, you know? Starts to worry about, and then, while he's still a long way off, like at the end of the field, right, he says, boy, oh my gosh, my son is home, right? I mean, just, he said, feels it. He runs out there, and he's running through the fields, and the son's walking to him with his head bowed down and all beat up, and the father's running at him, and he grabs him, and the kid says, Dad, I screwed up. I don't deserve to be called your son. Treat me. The father doesn't hear a word of it. Quick, put a ring on his finger, put shoes on his feet, put a robe on his. My boy is home. Of course, it's this energy of love and grace and forgiveness. It's so beautiful, right? And the message is that this is how God is with us. You know, there's a beautiful Franciscan prayer. We say, my God and my all, how I long to love you and give you my heart and give you my soul. I often teach that to people and I say, you know, think about this. As much as we long for God, God longs for us. Can you believe that? We got to believe that God longs for us. God wants us, wants to be with us, and seeks ways to find us. He comes after us, you know. That great Francis Thompson talks about the hound of heaven. God is like this hound of heaven, you know, just knocking things over to get to his son and daughter. This is an image of God that's really rich. And it's a better image than what we grew up with, am I right? So often we had that kind of ogre image, you know. A God who's like the state trooper, you know, just waiting for, I got one. There, I got a sinner. I got him, you know. Come on, really? You know, who taught us that? Where did that come from? I'm sure it wasn't you, sister. You know, this image of a God who's, there's a great story. There's a book that's called, you want to read a good book. It's called The Spirituality of Imperfection. It should be subtitled The Father Ed Shea Story. The spirituality of imperfection. If one thing I'm keep learning in my life is that the human condition is really funny. And I'm in it, and so are you. And to be able to laugh at ourselves and celebrate our own brokenness and the imperfection of life is really the goal. The spirituality of imperfection. Here's a story that's in there. A family goes camping. They're with a bunch of other families. And late in the afternoon, a little girl disappears. She's 7 years old. So the girl is off and she's wandering, and the people are calling her name, and they can't find her, and they're calling her name, and now they're getting scared. It gets to be dark, and they turn the lights on in their cars, and they're searching the woods. The kid's gone. Terrifying, right? And then they search through the night and until late into the night, and then they say, you know what? We'll get up early in the morning when it's light, and we'll find her in the morning. And so everybody goes to bed, but you know they can't sleep, and especially not the parents, right? So the father doesn't go to bed. He goes searches through the night, all night, going after and find every nook and cranny. And then early in the morning, just when it's about to dawn, he finds his daughter. She made her way into a clearing and fell asleep on the grass. Oh, thank God. Oh, my God. So the father's going over to get her, and as he's rustling up the leaves, the little girl wakes up and she says, Daddy, I found you. Think about that, right? Isn't that a great image of us, right? I mean, tell me, what is your image of God? Where did you learn it, you know? Mine is real fundamental, real human, you know? You know how I learned about God? From my parents. You know, when I was a kid, whenever kids were in college, by the way, did I tell you I went to Notre Dame? Oh, yeah. The sad story, at Boston College, they always say, how can you tell if you're with somebody from Notre Dame? And the answer is, you don't have to tell because sooner or later they tell you. Sad but true. So, I come home from college and there's, it's always, you know, college kids always come home at dinner time, am I right? You know, so you're wrestling, you're opening the back door, and my father would say, throw on the steaks, Eileen, the prodigal son is home. You know? It was like, I mean, think about that message, right? I mean, I'm just, geez, you know. And another thing my dad used to do, it was so great. We'd be at the table, and there was a rule, you know, from 6 to 7, you have to be at the table. Boy, you know, had family meal every night those days. So somebody would inevitably be late. You know, let's say one of my sisters was late. So when they were coming in, my dad would hop up and pick up the phone, and he would act like he's talking to the police. He'd say, yes, officer, no, she's here now. Thank you very much for your concern. You see what I'm saying? Like, there was, for me, that was like, wow, you know, God is like my dad. You know, God is like my mom. You know, my big deal. I started playing trumpet when I was 9 years old, you know, in the fourth grade. And I remember going to band practice early in the morning. I carry my lunch inside my trumpet case, you know, so my trumpet always smelled a little bit like peanut butter and jelly, you know, and years of practicing, and I just, you know, thankfully never quit. You know, kids start and quit a lot. You know, I just, for whatever reason, I never gave up on it. So I went to college and I hit the big time. I mean, I'm playing in the band at Notre Dame. Oh my gosh, it was so great. And I'll never forget the very first game. So I'm out there, bah, 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 I mean, it's great, right? And there's, you know, 50,000 people are there, and they're all following the band, and people are running along trying to keep up with the band, and I'm, bah, bah, and I'm just marching, and they have these fences and gates along the way, and I see this woman, running fast and jumping over the benches and trying to knock people out of the way. I looked over, I said, oh my God, it's my mother. This is it, see? This is what I learned about God. This is what I think God is like, right? God's like that hound of heaven. God's like this great image. Now, I want to invite you to get over some of the issues that we all had as this ogre-looking God. Listen to this quote. When he looked into each one's eyes, his look spoke volumes and healed many wounds and changed many lives. They could see in those eyes the love of God. As a church, this is our mission. As a church, this is what we're called to be. Those people who experience and share the love of God. And to the extent that we don't do that, we need to go to confession. To the extent that we fail, and we all do, we need to ask God for mercy. But it's not like pleading with God for mercy as if he's not going to give it to us. It's really much more about opening up your heart. You know, a couple months ago on the sixth Sunday of Easter, we had the gospel reading that Jesus said, this is my commandment. Love one another as I have loved you. And when I, for the first time in my priesthood, I read that text over and over. I've read it hundreds of times, right? And I realized, that is impossible. There's no way that we can love the way God loves. But this is what I said. I said, you know, I think the challenge here is to recognize that we can't do this completely, but everybody does it a little bit. I mean, think about people that you love, and think how you love them, and how they love you, right? I think the call to be a Christian in the world today has to do with getting in touch with that experience of love and then letting it expand, letting it open, letting it remind you of who you are, right? This is what reconciliation is about. You know, when at a baptism, the first question we ask is, what's this child's name? And then we say to the parents, do you understand what you're doing? And they say yes. And then we say, godparents, are you willing to help these parents? And then you say to the rest of the church, are you willing to take on the responsibility of this child? And then the priest gets to say, or the deacon, or the bishop, whoever gets to baptize, the most powerful words. You say, and first of all, you call the child by name, Abby. The Christian community welcomes you with great joy. In its name, I claim you for Jesus Christ with the sign of the cross. I now trace that cross on your forehead. Invite your parents and godparents to do the same. What a powerful thing, right? The Christian community welcomes you with great joy. And I think we spend the rest of our lives trying to get back to that. And we get back to it often, right? When you look into someone's eyes and you know the love of God, when you experience mercy, right? This is, you know, and think about this. We do the same thing every Ash Wednesday. Every Ash Wednesday. And this year is the first time I ever realized this. That's a bit baptismal gesture. We take ashes, a symbol of death, and then we sign the forehead of every person. It's a baptismal gesture. It's a reminder of baptism, right? Which is a reminder of that powerful relationship, personal relationship that you have with God. You know what I did this year at Ash Wednesday? St. Peter's is really a great place to work. We're able to be a ministry of presence in the loop. I got to tell you, I miss the baptisms. I miss the weddings. I miss all those family relationships. And that's why I'm gone a lot on weekends, because I'm doing that everywhere in all a bunch of other churches. But my experience of St. Peter's is really great in a lot of ways. One way is on Ash Wednesday. It's the biggest day of the year. We give out more ashes on Ash Wednesday than any church in the city. Probably any in the world. Maybe St. Peter's Basilica, I don't know, in Rome. But I'm saying, we got thousands from 6 in the morning till 7 at night, all day long. There's a great story about it, where the friar is doing it, and we are on for an hour at a time, you know. And so this is the modern age, and so the priest will say, remember, if it's a man, remember, man, that you are dust, and unto dust you shall return. And if it's a woman, remember, woman, you are dust, and unto dust you shall return. So just repeat that for an hour at a time, you know. And so at the end of the hour, the priest says, the guy walks up, and the priest says, remember, man, that you are woman. Okay, Father, time to take a break. You know what I did this year? You got 5 seconds with people. I mean, this is it. It's really a drive-through Ash Wednesday service. You know, we have masses and all the rest of that, but some people are just getting their ashes and going, right? So everyone that came, I asked them their name. It was so great, you know. All of a sudden, I had a moment of grace with a person I could name. You know, Julie, remember, you are dust, and unto dust you shall return. So turn away from sin and believe in the good news. This, I think, is what the essence of reconciliation is all about. It's about getting back to remembering who we are. When you go home tonight, call your grandchild or somebody that knows how to use their computer and look up a music video that's called Remind Me Who I Am. It's by a guy named Jason Gray, G-R-A-Y, Jason Gray. You probably could tell all these people. So it's called Remind Me Who I Am. Listen to what it says. This is a powerful thing. It says this: when I lose my way and I forget my name, remind me who I am. This is what I think sin is. I think sin is forgetting who we are, forgetting our name, forgetting that powerful connection that we have with God. When I lose my way and I forget my name, remind me who I am. When in the mirror, all I see is who I don't want to be, remind me who I am. In the loneliest places, when I can't remember what grace is, tell me once again who I am. So, listen, when my heart is like a stone and I'm running far from home, remind me who I am. When I can't receive your love, afraid I'll never be enough, remind me who I am. If I'm your beloved, can you help me believe it? You know, I think what we're talking about tonight is to reconnect with the essence of who we are, right? And that disconnect between the way we see ourselves and the way God sees us. You know, how does God see us? As beloved. On the day of his baptism, Jesus heard the word, and so did you, and so did I. You are my beloved. In you I am well pleased. And that's what we keep going back to. The video is really cool. They have, everyone has a piece of cardboard, like a sign. And it's all these, you know, their own self-image. So it says lost, or broken, or empty, or afraid, or, you know, all these messages, negative messages about yourself. You know, one of them is a guy with two little kids, and it says, I cheated on them too. You know, so think about the things you've done wrong in your life, right? And then kind of you just identify yourself with them. And what happens is through this song, as the guy's singing the song, little by little, all those people get rid of their cardboard signs that say those negative messages, and every one of them at the end has a sign that says, Beloved. Beloved. Isn't that nice? Let's sing.
Amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now am found. Was blind, but now I see.
All right, let's do something. Everybody stand up. I'm going to keep talking, so I don't want you to get too cranky. Get your bodies too. So look around and find somebody you don't know and introduce yourselves. Let's get to know each other by name. Want to get a drink or something? We're going to get right back to it.
I studied there too.
All right, let's get back to it. All right, so now, are we all in agreement about this image of God? It's a good one, right? It's something that goes deep. So, with that in mind, let's take a look at these two characters, the two sons, and how they, each of them is wrong in some way, and each of them is right in some way. So, let's sing.
Eye has not seen, ear has not heard, what God has ready for those who love him. Spirit of love, come give us the mind of Jesus. Teach us the wisdom of God.
You know this one? You know this song? Let's sing it.
Eye has not seen, ear has not heard, what God has ready for those who love him. Spirit of love, come give us the mind of Jesus.
Teach us the wisdom of God.
teach us the wisdom of God.
It's a beautiful song, isn't it? It comes from the second letter of Paul to the Corinthians. And, you know, whenever I read the letters to the Corinthians, I always remember when we were kids, we'd go to Mass, you know, and everybody come out of church and pile into the station wagon. And every once in a while, my dad would say, geez, you know, we got another letter from St. Paul today. Did anybody ever write back to that guy? It was such a human experience when I grew up. I'm just saying it, you know. And Paul, actually, most of what St. Paul writes is a response to some of the issues that were going on in the community. In Corinth, they had these people, they called themselves super apostles. They thought they were better than everybody else. I'm sure that doesn't happen here at St. Clement, you know. I had Mass a few months ago over at Old St. Pat's, you know. And Old St. Pat's is just this cutting edge, you know, young adult mecca, blah, blah, blah. And I was telling him, you know, I'm from St. Peter's, and we're the church where Chicago goes to confession, and I'd like to invite you to come and la di da. And I said, you know, we have theology on tap at St. Peter's also, and so it's Monday nights, and I was explaining it. And then I said, you know, you people ought to get out of your Old St. Pat's bubble. I was so proud of myself. No. So St. Paul's writing to these people and he's saying, look, don't get confused, right? The bottom line for Christians is love. The bottom line is how we love each other. You know, you go to all those weddings and they always have, Christina was telling us she went to about 12 weddings or something. And they almost always use that reading from 1 Corinthians 13. Love is patient, love is kind, is never boastful or rude. You know, it was never meant to be read at weddings. This was Paul scolding the Corinthians because they didn't love each other enough. It's very interesting. You know, you should tell the brides and grooms, they'd probably switch the reading. Because these people weren't loving each other enough. So Paul says, listen, you have no idea how great God is. You have no idea how wise and wonderful God is. Eye has not seen, ear has not heard what God has ready for those who love him. Spirit of love, come give us the mind of Jesus. Teach us the wisdom of God. Now, I want to invite you to think about the experience of that younger son. He comes to his father and insists that he has to get, you know, he has to break away. You know, you remember that, right? Every young man, every young woman has to break away from their parents. It's not a bad thing to want to break away. I often have this conversation in the confessional at St. Peter's because a lot of young people, young adults who come there for confession, they'll say, I'm having a hard time with my parents. I don't like the way I talk to my mother. I'm not happy with my relationship with my dad, you know, like that. And I'll say, you know, the thing is, you have to break away, but you don't have to be mean about it. You don't have to be nasty, right? And I think it's a delicate balance. It's not something simple, right? So this younger son needed to break away. I remember in my experience, you know, I grew up in a pretty typical family, a lot of fun, a lot of laughter, a little bit of alcoholism. My father was an alcoholic, and you know, he was a good man and a wonderful father, and paid for my way through Notre Dame. Did I tell you I went to Notre Dame? Paid for my way through college and all that. But he had this disease, and it was a bit of a problem, you know. I mean, as I got into my 20s, I finally started getting in touch with it myself, that I went to some meetings of adult children of alcoholics, and that really helped. And then I finally realized, you know what, I'm an alcoholic. And when I was 29, I joined AA. If I make it till January 23rd, 2016, I'll have 30 years of sobriety. Yeah, it's a great thing. But you know, when I first got into AA, I remember saying to my dad, you know, Dad, AA is great. You would love it. I mean, it's fun and funny and honest and good. And he didn't want to hear anything of it. You know, this was the one area of our relationship that was not okay. And I, you know, I'm a 29-year-old man. I'm trying to identify. And he was so mad at me for going to the meetings in the first place and going to those other meetings. And who the hell are you to tell me you think, you know, it was. And then when I got into AA, then I was really kind of like a champion of the AA. So I thought, Dad, you got to go. Why don't you just go with me? You know, I remember this one night I said, I would suggest to you that And he's cut me off. He said, I would suggest to you that you shut up. It was not a pretty scene. You know what I'm saying? And we used to get into these really painful arguments in public at the family gatherings, you know. And I remember this one time it really hit me. It was hard. My sister, younger sister, who was still living at home, she said, Eddie, you know what? We don't want you to come around here anymore. Because every time you leave, Dad takes it out on us. Because I was insistent. And I knew that I was right, that my dad would really do well if he'd go to the meetings. It would have been great. But then I realized, who am I to say that, you know? So it was hard. I was like that younger son, you know? And I remember finally getting over myself and realizing, you know what? I don't have to have this conversation with him anymore. I remember it was November 1986. I had like 11 months of sobriety, 10 months of sobriety. It was at my sister's house for Thanksgiving. My dad and I got once more into one of these big arguments. I got in the car, and I'm driving on Lakeshore Drive to the south side, and it was like a light bulb experience, like bling, Eddie, you never have to have that conversation with him again. It was so freeing, you know, and I never did. He died 8 years later, and we never talked about it. We traveled together, we hung around with each other. My sisters were always all amazed that, like, you went on a trip with Dad? Like, what did you talk about? Because he was hard to talk to and stuff. But you know what? It was a wonderful experience of letting go, right? And you know, he used to say, so, how those meetings? Talking to all my friends? Are they talking about me? And my response was, so how do you think those Cubs are going to do, Dad? You know,
Change the subject.
So, you know, there's a sense, like the young man is not wrong completely, but he's wrong in the sense that sometimes you get so caught up in yourself that you can't see the other side, right? He got so caught up in himself, first of all, he took half of his father's money and ran away. Then, when it went bad, he got overwhelmed with his own guilt. He got overwhelmed with his own fault and how bad he was. Notice what he says. I no longer deserve to be called your son. You know, he believes this. He believes that he's done being a son. You know, it's like that experience that we sometimes have with reconciliation where you go to confession, you confess it, and you say, okay, now I'm going to do better. And then you don't. And then you go back to confession. And then you go back and you go back. And after the fourth or fifth time, you're saying, you know, God must be so tired of hearing this. You know, maybe I don't deserve to be called your son. I mean, we can go to that place. Don't go there. I think that's the message of the story. God is not thinking of us as losers, as, you know, you no longer deserve to be called my son. God is at the gate saying, my boy is home. Look at this. Oh, this is great. And he knows that it's not going to be perfect, you know. Sometimes we make mistakes, and then we carry them around for the rest of our lives. Sometimes we do something wrong, and we never allow ourselves to be forgiven. Let me tell you a story. When I was working in Joliet, I was a pastor in Joliet, and I finished my time there, and then a good friend of mine became pastor. So I had the blessed experience of going out there once a month to do just the three Spanish masses. I didn't have to deal with the boiler. I didn't have to deal with the, you know, the complications. For several years, I have not been a pastor, and I got to tell you, I'm living a blessed life, you know. Being a pastor, a friend of mine always referred to it as the four L's, the job of the pastor. Locks, leaks, lights, and lawsuits. You know, when you're the pastor, you got to take care of all this different stuff. I'm the guy, comes in on the weekend, do my three masses, get a check, go home. Boom. Nice. Sign me up for that job, man. So I went out there every week. Well, there was this thing, this one lady who was a member of the church. She was like a church lady, you know. She's kind of like Rachel over here, you know, in charge of everybody. Kind of in charge, you know, everybody turns to her. So, and her name was Olga. And Olga's job, almost every mass, at the 12:30 mass, she always did the petitions, right? So, and she had this nasty habit of doing, like, for Tomas, let us pray to, who is sick, let us pray to the Lord. For Julie, who's sick, let us pray to the Lord. For Veronica, who's sick. You know, it's like too long, right? And I'd be like, you know, like put them together. You know, You know how it is sometimes when the prayers go on too long in church, right? I'm sure it doesn't happen here at St. Clement's. You know? So I remember, you know, it's like that time when you, or that those times when you hear, for all of those who are sick of our church, let us pray to the Lord. So anyway, I go to John to tell him, hey, John, we got to talk to Olga about this, you know, just a small thing. And John says to me, oh, Olga's mad at you. I'm like, mad at me? What the hell? Who can be mad at me? You know, this is a little embarrassing. But I'm always kind of surprised when I find out somebody doesn't like me. I mean, come on, you know, what's not to like? You know, I'm a positive guy, you know. I see the glass half full. And so she's mad. I'm saying, what the heck is she mad at me about? And he says, you know, I was talking about being not liking when people don't like me. I remember complaining to my spiritual director once about this. And I said, you know, I mean, I don't get it. Why, you know, what's wrong with these people? Why don't they like me, you know? And I'm always surprised when I find out somebody doesn't like me. And he goes, Ed, you know, I've known you for a lot of years. You should stop being surprised. Time to get a new spiritual director, man. So then I said, well, what the heck? Why is she? Well, she said that you called her an old lady in church. And I did. It was wrong. I realized it. It was like, oh my God, I did. I remember it was kind of a joke. And it had happened 3 months previous, right? And I was only there once a month. Right? So 3 months ago, it was time for the petitions, and I'm in this kind of good mood, and it's going good, and the mass is going good, and I'm like, all right, so now we're going to lift up our petitions. Where's that, the word in Spanish is la vieja, the old lady. Where's the old lady with the petitions? So everybody chuckled, right? And I thought, hey, I got something going here. Yeah. And so she comes up, you know. See, the thing is, husbands will sometimes call their wives vieja, you know, or gorda, which means fatso. You know, and but husbands can do that, but not some other guy. You know, so I say vieja, and then she finishes, she does the prayers, she goes down, and I say gracias vieja, no, thanks old lady, and everybody laughed again, right? So then I realized, you know, and that's what coming to his senses at last, right? This happens in life, right? So, you know, I was like, oh my God, I can't believe that. Oh, and so immediately I called her on the phone. I said, Olga, this is Father Ed.